Hey students, welcome. Thank you for tuning in to another video. My name is Dr. Loay Alzube. I am going to be talking to you today about a topic in rehabilitation engineering. In this video, I'm going to talk about the mathematical models that we are using in analyzing human movement. What I will be talking about today, it's supposed to be a short video in which I will be talking about what is mathematical modeling in human motion and why it is important for us. The reason why we would like to use mathematical modeling is because it is a powerful tool. It couples quantitative measures of human motion, which are, you know, I keep telling my students that we as engineers, we provide our services to healthcare providers. And those are in rehabilitation engineering and biomechanics. Most of the time, those are the physical therapists and orthopedic surgeons. Even sport coaches tend to use their assessment qualitative quantities. The beauty of mathematical modeling is that it is coupling quantitative measures of human motion, which are position, speed, and acceleration, ranges of motion. So all these quantities, the mathematical modeling help couples them with the theoretical concepts in physiology and mechanics. For example, Newton's second law. We would like to learn more about this. Our purpose in studying the models of human movement is to introduce the basic concepts in modeling of human motion, which the traditional ones are the ones that we know, which are inverse and forward dynamics. There are other ones, but we're going to focus on those. So if you want to investigate human movement through modeling, what are the things that the models will help us actually gain and obtain? If you use modeling, mathematical modeling, we have a better understanding of the movement, and which is this is very useful in preventing injury, because we can tell people that you are going to be, if you did this, if we have under these circumstances, there is a high probability of, let's say, falling and breaking one of the bones, so that's something good. We don't want to be testing protocols and procedures and interventions on people. So models are helpful, very helpful to understand the movement and predict when an injury could happen and prevent it. Another important use of modeling is estimating clinical parameters that are significant but difficult to assess. So as an engineer, if we are, talking about mathematics and numbers and quantities, position, velocities, and acceleration of a human motion, so what is the clinical relevant, right? So we'd like to find, something easy to assess. However, there are some quantities that are very difficult to assess. For example, the forces on the joints in a specific motor task. So we call this joint reaction forces. Those are difficult to assess directly from subjects. So models are very useful in this. And also we can measure something called stability indices. And those are also something difficult to assess directly. So the models, mathematical models, help us actually in diagnosis because it can give us an idea about quantities that we cannot actually attain by regular clinical assessment and procedures. The third one is estimating muscle forces, torques, work, power, and duration of activity of a specific muscle or a joint. And all of these, they're helpful in designing prosthetics and also in designing so to prevent fatigue. And in designing exoskeleton, which is now robotics, is becoming very, very, popular. So modeling is very important, and we can spend time in doing the mathematics in order, to study, to prevent injuries, help in diagnosis, and also help in design. So the types, as I mentioned before, the types of mathematical models used in human motion studies and analysis. So the first one is called inverse dynamics, and the other one is called forward dynamics. And we're going to learn more about these and what those mean. So before we dig into these two different, methodologies. So we need to make sure that the type that everybody understand that the type of model used, whether it's inverse or forward, in a research situation, depends on two things. First, what is the goal of the study? Right, that's the first thing that we need to ask ourselves. And the second question is, what is the type of data that has either been collected or is otherwise made available to us? Because these two points decide which one we're going to be using, inverse or forward dynamics. Please keep in mind that we are trying to understand human motion, and we are trying to use mathematics in order to build some models and to get some useful clinical information. So we have two models we're going to work with. So before doing or getting into the design, what is inverse and what is forward dynamics and how we can use those two methodologies, we need to understand something called idealization. So whether you're using inverse or forward dynamics approach, we must always include reasonable idealization of the structure that we are analyzing, in this case the human body, which is the anatomical and physical structure that is moving. We tend in biomechanics and rehabilitation engineering to idealize the human body in a two or three dimensional multi-segment coupled pendulum system, with the segments represented as either mass points or rigid body referred as a distributed masses. And I'm going to explain this in a bit. This picture here, and you can look at it, you can see that we have this idealization. This is the lower extremities of the body, let's say the legs. And we are trying to idealize them. Left and right leg with segments. See these long rods? And I have some of these dots with mass points. So before starting and before doing mathematical analysis and studying the human motion analysis, we need to simplify. So as engineers, we like to, and with working with mathematicians, the best thing to do is to simplify your structure. So if we have, this is the foot, this is your lower leg, and this is your thigh, and then you have, this is femur, and then you have your mass points distributed in the model. And if we have this is a two-dimensional structure, and as we mentioned before, it's a two-dimensional multi-segment. So this is one segment, two segment, three segment, and they're coupled, they're connected with each other. So this is a two-dimensional, the one to the left, two-dimensional multi-segment coupled pendulum system that represents lower extremities of the human body. So this is the first step. In three dimensions, the image to the right, you can see that we have X, Y, and Z instead of just X and Y. And we have our first segment, and it has a mass point. And this is the second segment, it has a mass point, and they're coupled together. So these are three-dimensional multi-segment coupled pendulum system. And we're going to learn more about these and how to analyze them in the future lectures. But the bottom line here that I want you to, or the take-home message, is that before we study dynamics, which is forward or inverse, we need to make sure that we understand idealization and how to use it. In the class, we're going to have an exercise to understand more what is idealization, how and what is the relationship between these segments and mass points in such a structure. And we're going to learn about that. So going back to our forward and inverse dynamics, now we know that why we want to use modeling. We know that we have two models that we use to analyze human motion. We introduced what is idealization, and we have an agreement that the human body is idealized as a two-dimensional multi-segment coupled pendulum, two or three-dimensional multi-segment coupled pendulum system. We need to keep that in mind. Now, the equations of motions are actually what is the mathematical formula that we're going to be using to analyze human motion. And either way you're using forward or inverse dynamics, you will be using the equations of motion. Even the more recent dynamical models that are used, they still use the equations of motion, but they're using the Lagrange instead of the Newtonian equations of motion, which is the work energy approach rather than the force approach. So in a nutshell, so the equations of motion, the definition of them, that they relate actual movement of the body to the applied forces, which causes the movement. And how the equations of motion are solved, this is what is the distinction between forward and inverse dynamics. And if we want to go through this in more details, so the first thing that we need to keep in mind that each modeling approach has its advantages and limitations. So if you look at the dynamics, we need to formulate the equations of motion. So we will rely on Newton's second law, which is force equals mass times acceleration. So if you are in a lab and you are given the forces, right? and you were asked to find the motion, this is called forward dynamics. So if you look at this formula here, force equals time acceleration, if someone give us the forces that produces the movement of the human body, divide the force by the mass, this is going to give you acceleration. And there's a lot of sensors that give you like accelerometers that will give you acceleration values. So if you give the, if you get the acceleration, you can integrate one time and this is going to give you the velocity. And if you can integrate two times, you have the position and that's your motion. So we started with forces and we ended up with a motion. This is called forward dynamics. On the other hand, if you were given the motion, which is actually the case in all human motion analysis labs, where they have infrared cameras and they will ask the subject to move and they will record the motion. So we started with the motions, which are the positions. So if you were given the motion, you have the position, you differentiate one time, you will get the velocity, you differentiate twice, you will get the acceleration, multiply the acceleration with the mass, and then you will get your forces. So in the inverse dynamics, we start with the motion and we end up with a force. In the forward dynamics, we start with a force and we end up with a motion. So those are the two most important models or dynamical models that are used in human motion analysis. And I want you to keep in mind that we are going to be working with both of them. But the distinction is, if you are in a human motion analysis lab or in a rehabilitation engineering lab, the data that is given to you determine which approach we will use. So if you're given the forces, you can divide by the mass, you get the acceleration, integrate a couple of times, you have your motion. If you're given the motion, which is the case of most actually human motion analysis that have the force plates and the infrared cameras, you have the motion, you differentiate a couple of times, you have your acceleration multiplied with the mass, and then you get your forces that cause that. And that is what I wanted to give you as an introduction about the mathematical modeling used in human motion analysis. If you have questions, please write the questions in the comment section and I will be more than happy to help you. And we're going to have more videos about human motion analysis and rehabilitation engineering. Come, stay tuned. Bye.